Everybody's having a wonderful day. Maybe got a little bit of a rain shower coming in. As I said, I love the rain and being able to drive through them. You know how that is. You know, hydroplaning and stuff. It's a lot of fun. But 286 in the songbook. It's good to be here safely tonight. Amen. 286. The glory may be with us.
So far, you know, we started off drawing out of God, and we were going home to be with the Lord last night, and that's a mighty good thing. I'm excited about that. Praise the Lord. I hope the rapture happens before we get out of here this evening. So it's good to have visitors with us tonight. We're glad you're here. Got a lot of good singing. Then Brother Mark Sproul is going to open God's Word and bring us what thus saith the Lord. And it's our prayer tonight that you'll be encouraged and you'll be helped and blessed. Being in the Lord's house tonight and by the preaching and teaching of His words. But we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. I'm going to ask my brother-in-law, Jason Wingard, if he'll lead us in a word of prayer tonight. Remember, Brother Irvin and Miss Deborah, they said they both were feeling really bad and asked us to pray for them tonight. So Brother Jason, you pray.
Come see the you.
Thank you.
to that day. What I thought of that day gets here sweeter. And I'm glad I don't have to wonder if I'm going to get there.
Right. Amen.
But I get to know, know we're going to get there. What a day that's going to be. We step into those gates.
Yes, sir.
See the one who saved us.
Yes, sir.
If y'all would stand on your feet now, we're going to sing page 8. We've had a special request from Titus back there. Sing page number 8. He loves this song. He's going to sing with us.
Excited about what God's going to do in this place. Got a few more good songs I want to share with you tonight. I want to encourage you to pray for different people out serving the Lord all over. The Old Time Preachers Quartet that'll be here on Friday with us. They are up in Kentucky, I believe. I talked to Brother Tim today, and they were there's a little bit of heated politics in that state and different things, but everything's going well for them. But he asked us to pray for his voice, and so I told him that the church would, whatever disinfectant they're using there is killing him. So y'all remember him, and just different folks that are out, and evangelism and different things. I think we've been reminded of that quite a bit this week with the pressures and the difficulties. We've obviously seen that in the church house, but those guys have really went through some things as musicians and singers and evangelists on the road. And so you pray for them as well. And I just want to stop for just a moment. We're going to have some other great singing. Brother Dan Oliver, would you take us to the Lord in prayer? Jim and Fulbright's going to come this way. The Lord sent them our way almost over a year ago now.
Amen.
They have been a tremendous, fantastic blessing to our church. Brother Jeremy said.
Thank you.
Thank you.
back in place. Father just wants the Lord to be lifted up tonight.
Yeah.
No other good Lord. Just him be lifted up. Brother Jesse going to share a song with us. And Brother Boyce, just pray that God will be real in this place like he's never been before tonight. Amen. Brother, you take us to the Lord in prayer. Brother Jesse going to sing a song. Brother Mark Stroud, bring the message.
Father in heaven, we're thankful tonight that you are precious to us. You're precious to us because you hung on that tree, that cross. You bled for us.
Thank you,
Lord. You died for us. Willingly gave your life for us. Thank you, Lord, for that. I thank you, Lord, personally for that. And I pray, Heavenly Father, just as you told your disciples, I go away that I may send the Spirit as your comforter. I pray, God, tonight that your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost of God would visit this place, have we need a revival. We stand in the same place that Paul and Silas did years ago. In that midnight hour, when they despaired of life, and they prayed and sang praises to the Lord. Lord, you shook that place apart. And I pray tonight there'd be a shaking in our hearts, a shaking in our lives, a shaking in our church. Lord, we pray for a shaking in our country tonight. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that you might just do for us what we need. And help us to lift up our hearts, our hands, our voices, and praise you for who you are and what you'll do for us, what you have done. And we pray you bless our speaker tonight. May you empower him with thy Spirit. I pray, Father, to give us a good reception in our hearts. We pray and ask all this in Jesus' name, giving you the honor and glory for what's done. Amen.
Man, it is good to be in church tonight. It seems like the Lord's just always tends to change my plans. I'll pray before church and I'll ask the Lord what to do. Lord, what should I do tonight? And you go to church and you feel like you know, and then the service takes a complete 180.
Thank you, Lord.
And that's good. Amen. I like that. It means the Holy Ghost is moving.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
And we love the Holy Ghost around here.
Yes, sir.
Amen. We appreciate it. Appreciate him leading us and guiding us in the way that we can't have church without the Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Lord.
There's a lot of ones that try, but I don't want to go there.
Right.
Amen, brother.
Brother Stephen was talking about pastors and evangelists and stuff, and this is kind of what triggered me to do this. Uh-oh, I got triggered. This triggered me to do this song, and I remember thinking March the 15th, I was packing up for a trip. I was going to go to North Carolina to a youth rally on the 16th. I'm going to fly in for this youth rally. And I had the TV on. I had Fox News on for probably one of the last times since then. It was just too depressing.
Yeah.
And listening to our president, our good president, Donald Trump, talking about closing the economy down and all these other good things that he was going to do. And then these governors got on and they're talking about closing the restaurants in their states and the shopping stores and all. They used the word non-essential. And Governor Cuomo from New York said, oh, yeah, you're not having church until I tell you you can. I'm like, what's going on? And my heart sank as an evangelist. Brother Stephen, we live off coming to churches, and we live off the kindness of God's people.
Yes, sir.
The Lord called us into a work, and he promised he'd take care of us.
Yes, sir.
But in my pea brain, I thought, man, this is going to be bad. I've got bills, and I began to repent. I said, Lord, forgive me for making bills for myself. I said, I don't deserve for you to pull me through these bills that I've made for myself, but Lord, please do something. And I flew on that trip the next day. I flew out to North Carolina. And two messages got preached there that really helped me. Dr. Bill Grady was in the meeting. He preached on the lights are still on in Goshen. The lights are still on in Goshen. How the Lord took care of the Hebrews as he was raining down plagues on Egypt. but Goshen was never touched.
Yes, sir. Not a flood.
And then Brother Mike Gray got up that night and he preached on, I Know the Peace Speaker.
Yes.
And it was like the Lord reaching down and just kind of nudging me and saying, hey, don't you know if I called you to this thing, I will continue to take care of you. I will continue to meet your needs. It's not going to be in the ways that you think, but I'm going to meet your needs while you're sitting at the house twiddling your thumbs. And I remember every bill got paid. I had extra money. There was nothing to spend it on. Amazon Prime wasn't delivering. I had extra money. God used lost people that didn't even know me to help me out. It was crazy. It was absolutely crazy. Philippians 4:19 says, my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory. He supplied all my need. He supplied all my want. But by about May the 10th or so, I was climbing the walls, Brother Stephen, in the same house. The only place I went was to church to play TV star musician every week, every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. That's the only place I went for just about a month. And I remember about the beginning of middle of May, I went to my closet, and this is going to sound weird, but I'm Jesse Craigle, so I hope you expect nothing less. But I started putting my hands on my suitcases. I started putting my hands on my church clothes.
Wow.
And I said, Lord, when you break this thing up, I said, Lord, the only thing I want to do is to get back on the road. I said, you've provided my needs. I said, I'm not worried about the money. I just want to go back out and I want to work. And I want to sing and I want to preach. And I want to share the gospel in churches again. Would you please open this thing up?
Yes, sir.
And I got a text message about the next day. He said, hey, we'll come down to Georgia and hang out with us for a couple of weeks. It was some friends down in Swainsboro. So we'll get you places to preach and you can sing and all this other stuff. And Brother Mike Norman down in Lake City, Florida, Brother Mark Stroud knows him. He called me. He said, you know, we've canceled our youth camp, but why don't you just come for a Sunday anyway and be with us? So I packed my suitcases up and Delaware was still shut down. But I went to Georgia. I went to Florida and I got my cup full of ministry again. And when I came back, I was only home for a week. And then I started doing youth camps. And things started to open up. And you know the rest of the story. My schedule's been busy ever since. But my God supplied my needs and spoke peace in the middle of that crazy, crazy storm. So this song's on my heart tonight. And I'll sing it before Brother Mark comes to preach. It was such a lovely day. The sun was shining bright. A gentle breeze was blowing my way. Not a storm cloud inside. Then suddenly, without warning, a storm surrounded my here's the reason why. with the power of the Spirit.
Verse 26, whose voice then shook the earth.
That's him. Yes, sir.
That's the one the preacher and his wife, sister, were singing about, oh, what a Savior.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. They turned around to Revelation 5 thinking a lion was going to open the book.
Yes,
and it was a lamb who opened
sir.
The book. You would think that it would have said in Revelation 6, for the great day of the wrath of the Lion had come. But it said, for the great day of the wrath of the Lamb had come. We think that Lamb's gentle. He is now, but when he comes back, he's not going to be not near as gentle as he was. He's not coming as a Savior the next time. The next time he comes, he's coming as a sovereign. And he's not coming to get us out of judgment like he's coming when he comes to rapture the church. When he comes in that second coming, he's coming to deliver judgment. And I praise God. I'm glad I'll be with him. Amen. On a white horse, praise God. Hallelujah. The Bible said, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also in heaven. Amen. It was Haggai that talks about that, about shaking that earth in heaven. Notice what he said, this word, yet once more, signifying the ruler of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. It might be every once in a while God shakes you up so that the things in your life that can be shaken will be shaken. So when all the shaking's done, what's left in your heart are the things that cannot be shaken.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm afraid too many times we're putting our hope and our trust in things in our life that can be shaken. I mean, we put them in our homes, we put them in our careers, we put them in our 401ks, we put them in the president, we put them in the Senate and the House, and we put it in the U.S. military, and we put it in all those sort of things that we think can take care of us. But what we found out in these last months, there's a lot of things where we've been counting on that you just can't count on. Sure. Some of our Christianity is relegated to a church service.
Yes, sir. Well,
you're not always, and we're finding out. We never thought we'd find it out, but we're finding out you might not always have a meeting to go to.
Right.
Our young people, we take them from youth meeting to youth meeting and camps and things like that, but those have been taken away.
Yep.
You know what's not been taken away? Your Bible.
Right. Amen.
Amen. Your secret place.
Yep.
Yes.
The Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Praise God. I'm glad. Thank God there's some things in my heart, in my life, that cannot be shaken.
Amen.
And I guarantee you, he needs to shake us up.
Yes.
And when we're said and done, we'll realize what we can trust in and what we cannot trust.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Appreciate that good song. I appreciate the praying. I like that, praise God, that meeting song. There's we're getting together not too long, praise God. And I'm looking forward to it. It's good to see in the house of the Lord. It's good to see Brother Darrell Hayes here tonight. I appreciate God's man. Many, many years. What a blessing. I'm glad there's some men that have not dipped their colors.
Amen.
Amen. I'm not slinging, not being mean, but there's a lot of men in my generation that are dipping their colors, and they're ashamed to be a Baptist, and ashamed to carry the Bible, and ashamed to live right and live clean and live holy. Amen. That's still in the Bible too.
Amen.
Amen. I appreciate men that have stayed true.
Amen.
And finished. I think about men that are passing off the scene, Brother Stinnett, Brother Sammy, and many of the heroes that I look to as a young pastor, a young preacher, a young Christian, those men are gone. Many of those men are gone. The Lord's left us with some that are still plowing a straight road to the end of the field.
Thank you, Lord.
And I'm thankful for it, preacher.
Yes,
may
sir.
God bless you. It's good to see our friends from Heritage.
Amen.
I thank the Lord for it. Exodus chapter 25, Brother Jesse has good singing, son. Choir, that was good singing. It is a grand and glorious feeling, praise God. Where's the little fella that wanted number 8, son? Wave at me. I like that number 8 pretty well too, buddy. Amen. And number 6 and number 14. I mean, I like a lot of them. But I'm real partial to that number 8. That's got that little bass part in there. I like that. And the more I scream and holler, the less tenor I sing, the more bass I sing. Amen. And there's one thing about it. I'm just about started getting back into preaching meetings. There's one thing I found out. My voice is not in preaching shape. Amen. But I appreciate you being here. Exodus chapter 25, when you find your place, let's stand together. You stretch your legs. Brother Stephen, thank you for allowing me to be here again this year. I don't ever take for granted the opportunity God gives me to go preach.
Amen.
And it's a blessing. A lot of guys, they like going new places. I like going new places. But I'm honored to get to go back to the same place.
Sure. Yeah.
Where I've got to, the pastor in me likes that because I've got to know that church.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I've got to know the people. I get to know the spirit of a church and the spirit of the pastor. And I enjoy watching the church grow and the people in the church grow. And God send people in and God save people and families grow. And what a joy it is to see that here. And I thank the Lord for it. Exodus chapter number 25. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel that they bring me an offering of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart, he shall take my offering. And this is the offering which ye shall take of them, gold, silver, and brass, and blue, and purple, and scarlet, and fine linen, and goat's hair, ram skins dyed red, and badger skins, and shittim wood, oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for sweet incense, onyx stones, and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. You can be seated. I'm interested in verse number 8 as our jumping off place tonight. The Bible said, and let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. I will preach for just a little while tonight on this thought. There's going to be a meeting. There's going to be a meeting. As you walk into the pages of the book of Exodus, if you studied your Bible very much, you realize that you walked in to one of the two books of redemption in the Old Testament. I think of those two books of redemption in the Old Testament, one being the book of Exodus, one being the book of Ruth. Aren't you thankful that, thank God, you don't have to wait to the Gospels. You don't have to wait to Mark. You don't have to wait to Matthew and Luke. And you don't have to wait till John 3:16 before you hear a message of the Gospel in the Word of God. I thank God. I think about the book of Ruth, of that great book of redemption by purchase. Amen. I think, well, they're down there at the gate in Ruth chapter number 4, and they brought the witnesses down to the gate of that near kinsman is there. The kinsman redeemer is there. Ruth is there. Naomi is there. They get to talking there at the gate. Boaz looked at that near kinsman and said, just look at here. He said, when you get ready to purchase everything that's Naomi's, understand you're going to have to purchase everything that has to do with Ruth. And that near kinsman, that picture of the law of God Almighty, made this statement. He said, I cannot redeem it because it will mar my inheritance. But thank God Boaz was ready to make a purchase. Aren't you glad that 2,000 years ago the Son of God hang between heaven and hung between earth, and God Almighty purchased our redemption not with the blood of bulls and goats, but with the blood of a spotless lamb. Our salvation was bought and paid for not by just a good man, not by just a good teacher, but thank God he was bought and paid for by the Savior of the world. Thank God. Our sin was paid in full by the blood of the Lamb of God. Aren't you glad you've been bought and you've been purchased? You're not your own, but you're the Lord's, because he bought and he paid for you. Amen. But Ruth was that book of redemption by purchase. But as you begin to walk through the pages of the book of Exodus, you'll find that it's not redemption by purchase, but it is redemption by power. The Bible said that the Lord brought the nation of Israel out of Egypt with an out outstretched arm. Can I tell you, in the day in which we live, if we're not careful, we'll be persuaded to believe that God has lost some of his power, and God is not as powerful as he's always been. But can I tell you, I believe in the day in which you and I are living, God's got as much power today as he's ever had. I'm glad he's still got the power to take the blackest heart of the most wicked sinner you know and wash it in the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and make them a new creature, set their feet on a rock and establish their going and put a new song in their heart. I'm afraid we're walking around twiddling our thumbs, thinking we're serving a second-rate God. I'm thinking we're serving a dead peasant in the grave. But I'm not serving a dead peasant in the grave, but a risen Savior who rose with power and with glory, and he's still got every bit of the power that he's always had to do the work of redemption in the life of anybody who'll trust and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. I think about these wilderness wanderings. The Bible said, Exodus 13:18, that but God led, he said, God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea. Now, some folks think that wilderness was sin. Well, it wouldn't be sin or God wouldn't have let them through it. It wasn't the traveling through the wilderness that was the problem. It was the wandering in the wilderness that was the problem. Amen. God was redeeming Israel and taking them from Egypt and going to put them in the promised land, of that land that God gave them. And can I say it's still theirs?
Amen.
I don't care what peace treaties are signed. I don't care who signs them. I don't care who gives it away. They can't give something away that's not theirs to begin with. But God, and listen, you need to understand something. You'll never get in time prophecy right until you understand the difference between Israel and the church. Listen, Israel's going to inherit this earth. For Israel, it's always been about the land. But thank God for the child of God. We're going to inherit that new heaven. Amen, friend. Thank God he promised it and he gave it to them and he's taking them there. But what about before he took them through the wilderness? God had prepared a shepherd, one that knew where the holes were. He knew where the danger lurked. He knew where the storms and difficulties would be. You say, who was that man? That man was Moses. He had spent 40 years in Egypt learning how to be somebody. Then he spent 40 years on the backside of the desert. I'm learning how to be a nobody. But then he spent 40 years learning how to lead anybody. Amen. God prepared Moses to bring him out of Egypt and take him into the promised land. Thank God he's got a shepherd for the people of God. Amen. Amen. The wilderness couldn't have been too bad. That's where Moses goes to the Mount of God and God gives him the law. That's where he gave them the instructions for the tabernacle, in the wilderness. We're living in a dry and a barren land. This is the wilderness we're living in. But I'm glad he's as much God in the wilderness as he was in Canaan, praise God. Amen, friend. I tell you what, I think about years ago on all the preacher studies, and when I was a young preacher, I had them. You remember that Brother Hayes, all those cassette racks we used to keep on keep. These kids don't even know what a tape is. They think tape's what you use on a Christmas present to put on the wrapping paper to wrap a present. But man, my walls used to be lined in my study of those cassette tapes. Of those old men of God, Brother Mays and Brother Edgar and Brother Canoy, these men of God that had preached in the days gone by. And I tell you, there was one tape in there that was preached in, I believe it was December, but it was in the year 1973. Dr. Harold B. Seitler walked to the pulpit on a regular Sunday night service, and he took the text in Psalm 78 and verse number 19. Yea, they spake against God, and they said, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? I've about wore that thing out. I think when he took that little part where it said, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? And he turned that text around just a little bit. And on that Sunday night, he preached on God can. God can. That's the problem we've got in our day. We don't believe that God can. You say, preacher, can God save my lost children? You better believe God can. Do you believe God can put my family back together? Can I tell you tonight, God can. Can God build an old-fashioned Bible-believing church in 2020 when the millennials are running crazy and turn their back on the Word of God? Let me just encourage you tonight. God can. Can God let his people in the house of God dwell together in unity? Can I tell you, God can. Can God support missionaries? God can. Can God take care of evangelists? God can. Can God pay the building note? God can. Can God pay your bills? God can. Can God find you a mate? God can. Can God use your life? God can. Can God save those ones you're witnessing to? God can. I'm as convinced as I've ever been. God can. And he still wants to.
Yes,
amen.
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 Yeah.
Hosea said he was going to take Gomer out there into the wilderness and speak comfortably to her. Aren't you glad in this wilderness that we're living in? God can walk in that wilderness with a child of God and speak comfortably to us. Glory to God. Amen. Can I tell you, listen, this world may be dry, but the well's not.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Everybody wants, he said, man, give me as much bread as you can give me. I'd give me a warehouse of bread. I'd rather have the baker than the warehouse. Can I tell you a witness? Sooner or later, the warehouse will run out. But honey, as long as the baker's walking with me, he can cook what I need. He can prepare what I need. You say, hey, if I had a big water truck, I'd have what I need. No. But when you walk with a well, that'll never run dry. It doesn't matter how dry it is around you. There'll be a vast supply of the water of God. I'm telling you, thank God he can speak comfortably to us in the wilderness. I'm glad God can provide a table in the wilderness. You make your way to Exodus 20. That's where God, for the first time, writes something down. He took him two tablets of stone and wrote the Ten Commandments. First time he ever wrote anything down. What about that? But then you come to our text in Exodus 25 tonight. God begins to give Moses instructions for the tabernacle of God. You think about the miracles that went on in the wilderness. They were led by a cloud in the day and a pillar of fire by night.
Yeah.
The manna was showered down from heaven. Not to feed just a family. He was feeding probably somewhere between 1 million to 2 million Jews.
Yes, sir.
And he fed them day and he fed them night. When they grumbled and complained that the manna from heaven wasn't enough, he started sending them some quail. Amen. I mean, good night. Boy, they were murmuring when God was feeding them. They weren't paying anything. But what about that? He didn't get upset. And he didn't get judgment. He just helped them and provided for them. I don't believe even the greatest miracle might have been when he laid that tree down in the bitter waters of Marah and made it sweet. What about that strong wind that came through there, separated the Red Sea?
Yes, sir.
I mean, listen. I don't think they needed help waivers. I don't think they needed chess waiters.
Right.
I don't think they needed no chicken boots from Walmart. And if you don't know what that is, praise God, you ain't live where I live in the poultry capital of the world. Them black Walmart boots, it's got red about this color card on the bottom. I mean, amen. It don't matter if you're stepping in chicken manure, cow manure. Hey, I mean, that's just them old galosh boots. Amen. I believe it's like them little youngins was walking through there. I mean, neighbor, when you're taking 1 million, 2 million people across a body of water, I'm not talking about no 3-foot doorway. I'm not talking about no 3-0 door or no 6-0 door. I mean, thank God when the Lord makes a way, he makes big ways.
Sure. Yes, he does.
Amen.
Amen.
I mean, the youngins, it'd been like you taking your boys across through there. They'd have thought you took them to the Atlanta Aquarium, praise God. They'd have been over there sticking their finger in there, look at them fish. Oh, the liberals will say, ma'am, I just don't believe the Lord pardoned the red. Half our Bibles don't even have the right maps in them. They got that little Red Sea like it's a little brook or a little creek. And they will say, well, I just don't believe the Lord pardoned the Red Sea. Well, that's fine. They think, well, I just think they went across a creek. Well, believe that if you want to. That just means it means that the Lord drowned the entire Egyptian army in a creek.
Amen.
Believe it however you want to. There's a miracle in that he parted the Red Sea. That's what the Bible said.
Yes.
Or if you want to just doubt the word of God and believe that he parted the creek, just go ahead and shout on the fact that the entire Egyptian army drowned at the bottom of the creek.
Yes, sir. Amen.
You say, well, you're serving. I'm serving a capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. I'm serving the Lord that said, I am the Lord, and there's none else beside me.
Yeah, amen.
I think about that snake on a pole.
Yeah.
The Lord said, just look down at that snake. I think about the crossing of the Jordan. What miracles.
Amen.
Yes.
Water from the rock. Brother Hayes, I don't know if any of those are the greatest miracles of the wilderness experience. If you go back to Genesis 1, you'll find this statement 9 times. And God said.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
I'm talking about, Brother Mike, it took one chapter to make everything that was made. I mean, one chapter to make everything that was made. He gets to talk about making the sun. He gets to talk about making the moon. And then he makes this statement. He made the stars also. I mean, I'm talking about the Milky Way and all those other galaxies that we've never seen. The Lord just stepped over that in 5 little words and said, yeah, I made the stars also. I mean, man, it doesn't matter how powerful a telescope we find. It doesn't matter how far that we can send a satellite. It doesn't matter how far we can go in our space exploration. Just at the moment we think we've figured something out, they'll get another satellite. They'll find another telescope. And look out there and say, man, back to the drawing board. We thought we knew something, but now we realize we don't even have a clue about everything God did, and he did that in 5 little words.
Amen.
I almost feel like it was like when we were boys, when I was a little boy and at home, my daddy, when we would work in the yard, he had one of them little seed sacks, and it was a little seed sack that laid in there. And he'd stick his hand in that grass seed, And he'd just fling, boy, we'd aerate that yard. And I'd walk around like a little fella thinking my dad was a, he'd stick that hand in there and just cast that grass seed out through there. And Brother Welch cast that grass seed. I learned this a little bit what it was for the Son of God. I mean, he'd step down on the platform of nothing, pull back the curtain of nowhere, and stuck his hand in his little satchel, and pull out a handful of stars, and cast the Milky Way into its place. I mean, good night, friend. I'm talking about a God who the mountains are his footstool. His hair is like silver, his eyes are like fire. I'm talking about a God that made the entire universe in a five-word statement. But when he got ready to talk about a place where he was going to want to meet with his children, he didn't make a five-word statement. Brother Jesse, he wrote 50 chapters.
Yes, sir.
To talk about a place that we refer to as the tabernacle. About a place where he was going to, for the very first time, come and meet with his people. Could it be that it's not the Red Sea? Could it be that it's not the manna? Could it be that it's not the palm tree, or those 70 palm trees, that tree put in that bitter waters of Marah? Could it be that it's not the water out of the rock? Could it be that it's not the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night? Or could it be that it was not the brazen serpent on the pole? But could it be the greatest thing that ever happened in the wilderness? That God designated a place where he could come and meet with his children.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Amen. I'd say it's pretty important stuff.
Yes, sir.
Pretty well gives us an indication what he cares about.
Amen.
Everybody's worried about the environment.
Yeah.
All things were made by him.
Yes, sir.
And by him all things consist.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Do our green peace people really think they can sustain God's creation? I read one place years ago, if the countries of the world had to feed the birds every day, they'd go bankrupt in one day.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I hadn't seen the Lord having an IPO to raise funds to feed the birds.
Yes, sir.
So what's an IPO? An initial public offering, where a private company goes public to raise some funds. The Lord ain't digging up the streets of gold to feed the birds, friend.
Right.
Amen.
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 Yes, sir.
Look at your Bible, Exodus 25. He gets ready to take up an offering from the people of God. They're going to build God a sanctuary that he may dwell among them. Notice what he said first of all. He said, I want you to bring me some gold. The very first thing that the Lord asked from the nation of Israel is gold. And gold speaks of deity in the Word of God. To me, that's not even, as I thought about that gold, Exodus 25, last time I checked, Exodus 25 come before Exodus 32. You say, what do you mean, preacher? We know the Lord knows the end from the beginning from the end. And what about the very first thing, Brother Jesse, he asked them for? He knew that seven chapters later, they were going to break their gold earrings off their ears and look at Aaron and say, make me a god. What about the very first thing he wanted from them was the thing that just in a few short chapters, they were going to break off their wrists and take out of their earrings the very thing that God let them spoil out of Egypt? He asked them for it first, knowing they were going to give it to a false god. That's a long-suffering Lord right there. I wonder how many things that the Lord wants out of our life that we're giving to a false god. What about that silver? Silver's the word of God. Psalm 126, word of the Lord, pure word of silver, try the fire. Furnace of earth, purified seven times. brass, picture of the judgment of God. Blue, it's a picture of heaven. I remember Brother Hayes 25 years ago now. On a Saturday night at People's Baptist Church while Dr. Wright was still there, Brother Johnny Pope flew in from Texas and preached a youth meeting on that Saturday night, and he preached on the ribbon of blue. Boy, he got to preaching that night, man. It stuck with me, if I remember. I can't remember what I preached 25 weeks ago, much less what a man preached 25 years ago. What he got to talk about that little woman, that issue of blood, since she touched the hem of his garment. You know what that hem was in that high priestly garment? It was a ribbon of blue. She done reached in there and touched something from another world. Praise God. No wonder her issue of blood drew up. No wonder she was made whole. She reached in and touched the power of God Almighty. He said, hey, bring me some blue. He said, bring me something from that heavenly world. Amen. Talks about that blue. Then notice what he said, purple. You remember that old song from years ago by purple robe my Savior wore. Oh, the shame that he wore. Royalty. Then notice what he said, scarlet. Scarlet. What did the Lord say? I remember years ago, Temple Baptist Church, Mount Airy, North Carolina. One of the first revivals I went to after being called to preach, Brother T. Invited me to come up and listen to Brother C.O. Roach preach.
Yeah.
That old man of God. Yes, man, that had to be a little bit like what the Apostle Paul must have been like with Dr. Roach. He preached that word. He preached that week on those phrases. I am a worm.
Yes, sir.
Wow. Most of the time, that worm in the King James Bible is translated rima, which means maggot.
Yep.
But in Psalm 22, when the Lord speaks of it, he said, I am a worm. He said, I'm a no man. I'm a worm and no man. That word there is toloth.
Yes.
That word toloth right there is not a maggot, but that's the scarlet
worm.
That's it. You say, what is it about that scarlet worm? They call it the crimson worm. When it's time for that crimson worm to have her children, you know what she does? The crimson worms, you know what they do? They mate for life. I just thought I'd tell you that. They mate for life. One bride, one groom. You know what they do, Brother Ben? When the crimson worms, the mamas get ready to hatch their young, you know what they do? They attach themselves to a tree.
Yes, sir.
Wow.
Glory to God. They attach themselves to a tree. When she attaches her body to that tree, what she does, she makes a hard crimson shell. And said, under that hard crimson shell, she will give birth to those little worms. And you know what they do? When she bursts those little worms underneath that hard crimson shell, they begin to feed off of that mama worm. They said after about 3 days, those little worms are strong enough to live by themselves, and that outer shell goes from scarlet to white.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
And said when that scarlet worm has died, they've eaten her, said that hard crimson shell that's now white begins to fall to the ground. And those worms come out. Though my sins be as scarlet, I shall be white as snow.
Yes, sir.
And you know what they tell me when that worm's done on that fence post or on that tree where it attaches itself? It has stained the tree or the fence post a scarlet red.
Amen.
Whoa, he said, bring me some blue. Bring me some scarlet. Aren't you glad our Bible's put together perfectly?
Yes, it is. Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
Notice fine linen, a priesthood. Well, Hayes, our hyper-dispensationalist brethren will tell us they can't find Jesus in the Old Testament. I would say to them, they're reading it with their eyes closed.
Amen.
That's exactly right.
I can see him in Genesis 1.
Yeah.
I can see him in the ark. I can see him in the scapegoat. I can see him in the burnt offering. I can see him in Genesis and Exodus and Leviticus and Deuteronomy. And listen, the Old Testament is not about Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, and Noah and Moses. But the Son of God is the hero of the Bible. But from Genesis to Revelation.
Yes, sir.
And fine linen's a picture of the priesthood. Amen. Notice what else he said. Goat's hair, ram skins dyed red. That ram skins dyed red was the top. No wonder when the Lord looked down, he saw that red.
Yes, sir.
No wonder we can fellowship with him. When he looked down there, he saw them ram skins dyed red. Then he said badger skins and shittim wood. Oil for the lights, spices for anointing oil, and for sweet incense, onyx stones and stones. I'll just mention this to you. There's 15 things listed in that list. You know, the reason we get to meet with the Lord, the divine grace of God.
Amen.
3 and 5, praise God.
Amen.
But I'm struggling. I'm struggling with one of those. I understand gold. I understand silver. I understand scarlet. But there's one of those things he said, I want you to give me that I'm struggling with. You say, which one is it, preacher? What about that? Goat's hair. Any of y'all men that's got a wife and a television, there's a curse in your home called HGTV. It's amazing. When your wife watches that HGTV, all of a sudden she thinks her middle name is Joanna Gaines.
Yes,
and when she looks at you through the eyes of HGTV, she thinks you're Chip.
Yes.
And she thinks you can do what he does. I am a banker by trade and now a preacher. I can't build anything. I can tear it up, but I can't build it.
Yeah.
I mean, man, we got ready to tear down the church. I pushed down the whole block wall in my office. I just want them to know I still had it in me. Amen. But if you ask me to build it back, can't help you. You ask me to finance it at the bank, I can help you. Two of my men took me hunting back in the fall. I went elk hunting for the first time for our pastor appreciation. Man, we had a wonderful time. And I FaceTimed Miss Amy back while I was there. And she got on the phone, Miss Lynn, and I looked and I said, where are you at? I couldn't figure out where she was. She said, I'm in the boys' bathroom. And I thought, oh. She said, I'm tired of this wallpaper. So I'm tearing it off. Y'all saw her. She's 5'2". We have 9-foot ceilings. She left more than she took off. So you know who took the rest off? You're looking at it. There was a lot less low work than there was high work. And she knew if she ever got that wallpaper off that wall, it wouldn't just be the painting going on. Then there'd be new countertops, and there'd be new paint, and there'd be new fixtures.
Yeah.
She said, I didn't ask all that. She knows I'm not going to do it halfway. If you don't think she knows how to get what she wants, sir, you ain't been married long. Just hold on. Brother Hayes, you pastored churches for a long time, built a deck brick. Did Miss Hayes ever look at you and say, now, preacher, I know. You know, they got these what they call showpiece walls now. Did your wife ever look at you and say, preacher, I know what'll fix that for you. I know what'll just top it off. We need to put some goat hair on the wall. Brother Ben, you peeled and y'all peeled, and she ever looked at you and said, man, I tell you what, Daddy, praise God. That wall right there in the hallway where he put all the pictures of the children, that little showpiece wall, I know what'll finish it off. What about 3 good rolls of some goat's hair? I don't believe she's ever said that. Hey, I'm not talking about a fixer-upper. I'm not talking about the White House.
I'm not talking about the Biltmore estate. I'm talking about the very first place that God was going to designate to meet with his children. He said, bring me some goat's hair.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, it would been the first veil you'd have had to cross through to get in the outer shell. Now, what do we use as our first principle to understand words when we find them in our Bible? What do we use? What's our law? The law of what? First mention. Would anybody care to guess where the law of first mention of goat's hair is? Exodus 25. Ain't that a lot of help? Can I say this to you? Even though it's mentioned by name in Exodus 25, we've seen it before. You say, where are you talking about, preacher? Genesis 27. Isaac's dying. And he called Esau in there to him and said, man, I don't know when I'm, he said, I'm old and I don't know when I'm going to die. He said, I'll tell you what I want you to do. I want you to go out there and get me some venison. You come back and make it into some savory meat that I may bless you. See, already he had already traded his birthright for a little morsel. How many of us are trading eternal things for a moment of pleasure? How many young people will trade their future and for just a little temporal moment?
Yes, sir.
That's what Esau did. He's a man of the flesh. So what did he do? He went out there, but Rebecca was over and heard what she said. What he said to him. She went over and got her favorite and told Jacob, he said, look at here, you're going to go into your daddy. And he said, I'm going to fix him. You're going to go get me two good kids from the flock and you're going to bring them to me. I'm going to dress them and I'm going to make them into that savory meat that your dad. And you're going in, he said, but mama, there's a problem. Esau is a hairy man and I'm a smooth man. She said, you just go get the goats and bring them to me. So what did she do? She took those goats and she dressed them and made them into the savory meat. And then she put the skins on Jacob's arms. And Jacob walked in and she said, I'm here, Daddy. He said, man, how'd you get back so quick? He said, the Lord brought that venison to me. Wow. He said, come near. Because he deserved it. He said, man, you've got the voice of Jacob.
Yep.
He said, but you've got the arms and the smell of Esau. He got close to him, and he put his hands on him arms of Jacob, and he felt that goat's hair. And the Bible said he discerned him not, and he blessed him. You say, what's that goat hair mean? That goat hair might indicate that we are the brother that didn't belong. Brother Hayes, could I say it this way? Jacob came in the garments of another man. He put Esau's clothes on. Brother Jesse, he didn't just come in the garments of another man. He came in the name of another man. Glory to God. Yes, he came in another man's name. And Esau, Jacob came with another man's work. He didn't bring the works of his own hands in there.
Right.
He came in there with the works of his mother Rebecca. Wow. And can I tell you, when I came into the presence of God Almighty today to pray, I came in the garments of another man.
Yes,
I came in the name of another man. I came with the works of another man.
That's
I am the brother that didn't belong.
Right.
I wonder when God told him to put that goat's hair on that tabernacle, but that he put it out there so they'd realize that they shouldn't have got the blessing, but they shouldn't have got to come in because the work of another man, because the garments of another man, because the name of another man, we are the brother that didn't belong. Dear time, that ought to make a Presbyterian shout, praise God. I think about Matthew chapter number 1, the genealogy of the Son of God. Pretty different than Adam's genealogy. Over at Adam's genealogy, they said so-and-so begat so-and-so, lived how many ever years and died? And died and died and died. You get into the Lord's genealogy in Matthew 1, ain't nobody died, everybody's just living. Could that be what Romans said? And Adam all men die?
Yes, sir.
But in Christ, all men are made alive.
Amen.
Good night.
Amen.
Matthew 1. There's three men in Matthew 1 that didn't beget anybody in that genealogy. Zerah, Urias, and Joseph. The way you get into genealogy is you beget somebody. Them three men got in there, and in that genealogy, they didn't beget anybody. You see how they get in? Same way we got in, by the grace of God.
Amen.
I didn't belong. East Jacob didn't belong. That was Esau's blessing. But thank God we got a blessing that was not ours.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Matthew chapter 1, there's five women in that text, in that genealogy. Go by the Old Testament, you never find a lady mentioned in the genealogy, only the men. And it's even better than that, Brother Hayes. Three of them women are Gentiles. Please explain to me how three Gentile women get in the genealogy of a Jewish Messiah.
Wow. That's good, brother.
I mean, good, they don't belong there. Rahab didn't belong there. Ruth didn't belong there. But thank God they got in the same way you and I did. We came in the work of another man. We came in the name of another man. We got in where we did not belong.
Yes, sir.
There's more I can talk to you about the names. It's how many times they're in the last book. Honey, I'm preaching long. I'm tired. I'm wore out. I'll just give you this other one, Song of Solomon 4:1. We're not only the brother that didn't belong. But Song of Solomon 4:1 said this, but thou art fair, my love. Behold, thou art fair. Thou hast dove's eyes within thy flocks, and thy hair is as a flock of goats.
Yep.
I'll just say to you, young men, don't use that line on somebody you want to marry. Because you not only will not get a date, you might not live through the night. You know that's the truth. Jesse, try that, sir. Try that one time. Say, well, your hair is like a flock of goats. Make sure that you FaceTime me because I want to watch her whip your hide, praise God. Solomon was talking from the eyes of the shepherd, and he knew what made those flocks what they were.
Yeah.
And I'll just say this, and I'm going to move on. I won't preach this. I'll just give it to you. We're not only the brother that didn't belong, but we are the bride to be.
Thank you, Lord.
He's talking about his bride. This world, just like, we don't understand that flock of goats, the hair is like a flock. Don't, let me just say tonight, y'all get a date night somewhere down the road and you take her out to that nice dinner down there in Atlanta somewhere, you know, like Bones or Chops or Fogo, you know, hallelujah. Amen. Don't look across the table and say, hey, baby, pull your hair like a flock of goats. She may live wealthy for the rest of her life. Your insurance money, praise. This world looks at the bride of Christ and thinks, what's so special about that? The problem is they just can't see what we mean to him. Turn your Bible to Leviticus 15, 16, 17. I'm almost done. Brother Jesse, come back to the end. I'm almost done. We're not only the brother that didn't belong, the bride to be, but I want to spend a little time in Leviticus. Leviticus 15, 16, 17. We're not only the bride to be, we're not only the brother that didn't belong, but we're the believer that all things have passed away. Matthew 25, verse 32 through 40 talks about he's going to separate the sheep from the goats. He's going to put the sheep on his right hand, the goats on the left hand. Goats aren't getting in. I guess that's why it's a good thing he said, I want goat's hair. Don't bring me some goats. Bring me some goat's hair. And they ain't but one way you're getting hair off a goat. You're going to have to take his life. Look at your Bible, Leviticus 15, 16, and 17. Leviticus 16 is the great chapter of the great day of atonement. Could I say it this way?
But Jesse, and I believe I'd be right, and Brother Hayes, feel free to correct me. Leviticus 16, that great day of atonement, we can term it this way. That's an Old Testament Calvary.
Yeah.
That's the Old Testament picture of what the Lord was going to do in, Luke chapter number 24. You see such words as atonement, verse 6 and verse 8, two goats and scapegoat. And look at verse 10, scapegoat, atonement and scapegoat. You know how many times you find the word atonement in your King James Bible? 80 times in the Old Testament, one in the New. 808, new beginning. All that old's testifying about the one that's in the New. Blood's being shed. But flip your Bible back to Leviticus 15. Look at verse 2. The Bible said, when any man hath a running issue out of his flesh, then you can look at verse 15 and 16 and 17 and 18 and 19. It's talking about uncleanness and sexual sin. Some of the most private sins that could be committed are in Leviticus 15. Secret sin. The Bible said he committed fornication, a sin against his own body. Now look at Leviticus 17. In Leviticus 15, we've got sins against our body. Look at Leviticus 17 and verse number 7. The Bible said they shall no more offer their sacrifices unto devils after whom they've gone a whoring. In Leviticus 15, you've got sins against our body. Leviticus 17, you've got sins against his body. And what about right here in the Old Testament? He took some of the most awful sins right under the shadow of an Old Testament Calvary. He took some sins against our body right before, and then he took some sins against his body right after. I'll just say this to you. Brother Jesse, there's more blood in Leviticus 17 than any other chapter in the Bible. What about there was more blood after Calvary, the Old Testament Calvary, than there was before it? Can I just say, I got saved at 13 years old. I did most of my sinning against the Lord after I got saved than I did before.
Right. Yeah.
I'm ashamed of that, but that's the truth.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I got saved at a young age, never knew anything but the house of God. I didn't even know there was a liberal church. I thought the Bible was the Schofield Bible. Because Brother Edward got up every Sunday morning and said, open the Schofield Bible. And he'd say it this way, Brother Hayes, if you got the right Bible, turn the page, whatever it is. And we all had the right Bible. Amen. So when I got saved and I got in my teenage years and got backslid on God, I did more against him after I got saved than I did before. When I saw this truth not too long ago, I sure did rejoice. There was more blood after than there was before. Hallelujah. He's talking about a scapegoat and atonement. Hey, Brother Stephen, come here and be my high priest. Let me borrow one of them little fellas right there. Come here. Either one of them, come here. I need one of them. I don't need two now, baby. I need some men. I need somebody to give me. I need five $1 bills. I mean, right now, five $1 bills. For real. Y'all think I'm playing. I need five $1 bills or a $5 bill. Right there's three $1 bills. He done pulled too many out. You don't, amen. Come on, there's five. We're going to help. I'll take all you got right there. Amen. And that's the wrong thing to bring money to a preacher. Say, how much you need? I need everything you got in there. I need that 100 that's behind that driver's license, praise God. Here, put that in your pocket. I took up an offering for him helping me. Hey, Brother Hayes, come help me. Come be my fit man. Come here and help me. Come here, Brother Ben, and help me. You got your coat? Get your coat. Brother Ben, you come right here and stand. Come here, you stand in the middle. Come here, my brother, my senior brother. You go back there and stand in the back, y'all take your coats off. Ain't that a blessing? I'll let you put your coat on and take your coats off.
You sure?
Yeah. Well, go ahead and take it off. Thank God for security. You keep it on. Amen. These Antifa folk, they said, we coming to the suburbs. I thought y'all better stay in the city. These rednecks I live with, they've got their scope signed in however long their driveway is. Amen. Ain't that the truth? Come here, my girl. Great day of atonement. The high priest would take those two goats. He'd slay the one, then he'd put his hands on top of that scapegoat. And he would confess the sin of the nation of Israel on that head of that scapegoat. And then the Bible said that a fit man. Brother Michael, you know how many times you find a fit man in your Bible? One time. You say why? Because there ain't but one fit man. They wasn't but one qualified. Yes. They wasn't but one qualified to take our sins into a land uninhabited. And that fit man would take that little goat by the, come on, preacher man. Y'all stand right there. Get your coats ready, boys, in your hand. That fit man would lead that scapegoat. Boy, these sentinels would be posted in the mat. The entire nation of Israel was back there with the high priest. He was taking this scapegoat out into a land uninhabited. And these sentinels were posted in the high places in the mountains. And you would have watched as that fit man took that scapegoat out of your sight. You'd be watching till he came through.
Thank you, Lord.
And he'd take it out of sight. And he would take that scapegoat to where it could not be seen. And the fit man would go out of sight. And these guards were waiting. They saw it go out. And all of a sudden, in the sight, here would come the fit man. The difference is, this time, the scapegoat was not with him. And son, as soon as that first sentinel, he would have had a flag in his hand. And as soon as he saw the fit man come back in the sight, he'd start waving the flag. And this sentinel would see that guard waving his flag and let him know that the fit man had came back into sight. And then the next man in the row would be waving his flag, and the high priest would be waiting to see the signal, and he would see the sentinels waving the flags to indicate him that the scapegoat was gone, and he would announce to the nation of Israel, our sins are gone. But the whole soul runs here. You ask me why I'm happy, and I'll just tell you why. Because my sins are gone. Listen, 2,000 years ago, he bore our sin in his own body, and he took them into a land uninhabited.
Yeah.
And you and I can rejoice that the scapegoat took our sin away.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Yeah.
We're the bride to be. We're the brother that didn't belong. And we're the believer whose sins have passed away.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
I'm glad that I understand just a little more, maybe, why he said, bring me some goat's hair. Because I got a blessing that I didn't deserve. I'm going to a wedding that I shouldn't get to go to. And I'm a new creature in Christ because my scapegoat took my sin away. fellas. Thank you, preacher. Brother Jesse's gonna sing. Child of God, what about a Lord that said he was gonna make the stars in five words, but wrote 50 chapters about a place that he wants to meet you, or he wanted to meet the nation of Israel. And if he wanted to meet them, you can better believe that he wants to meet with you. I want you to think about, you were the brother. That elder brother got that double portion, birthright and blessing. But Jacob got something that wasn't his. I'll just thank God that I got something that I shouldn't have got.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
I like that old songs in the cathedrals that used to sing it. Is that wedding music? I hear. The bride's adorned and ready to appear. There's heavenly preparation for a wedding celebration. Is that wedding music? I tell you one thing, he certainly saw something in us that I've never seen in myself. And I promise you, this lost world's never seen it. And I want to thank God because of that goat, the scapegoat that took our sin away. We're the believer whose sins have passed away. I wonder why Brother Jesse sings. How many of us would like to slip around an altar and just thank him that you came in another man's garments with another man's works in another man's name. We're standing on